In the previous class, we derived voltage equations of a synchronous machine. In fact, we applied Faraday's law and we got the relationship between voltage and fluxes, and of course, the relationship between fluxes and the currents. Also, we tried to get a relationship, that relationship is the inductance matrix, which it turns out is a position is position dependent, that is theta dependent. Remember, an important thing is that theta is continuously changing in a synchronous machine. So that inductance matrix in fact is time dependent, it is dependent on the theta position. Okay. Now, in today's lectureWhat we will do, this is the lecture is a continuation of the modeling of a synchronous machine. We will introduce you to a transformation of variables called the TQ transformation or the Parks transformation. In the previous lecture, we kind of concluded at the point where we derived the equation of torque in terms of the current. We will just redo that again at the beginning of the lecture, just to refresh your memory, and then we move on and I will introduce this transformation which I just mentioned. Now, if you recall what we did last time, for the mechanical equations of a synchronous machine, so if you have got a synchronous machine which is moving in this direction with a mechanical speed of omega m, and it has got electromagnetic torque, which of course opposes the motion, and the prime mover torque T m. So, if you look at the equations of this system, you have J is in fact the moment of inertia in kg meter square. So, this is a well known equation which describes the rotation, and the electrical torque by basic electromagnetic energy conversion, basic electromagnetic energy conversion formula tells you the electromagnetic torque is given by the partial derivative of the co-energy with respect to theta. Okay, so the torque in this direction, and remember theta is measured in this direction, in the anticlockwise direction. So, in that case you have this, the co-energy of course is a function of the currents. So, when I take the partial derivative, I should keep the currents constant. The co-energy is defined as half of I s transpose I r transpose. I s and I r, remember, are the L inductance, the inductance matrix of the rotor of the system. We already derived what this L matrix is. In fact, three of its sub matrices are in fact functions of theta. Okay. So, L is in fact made out of sub matrices LSS, LSR, LRS and LRR, out of which LRR is not theta dependent, but all the rest are theta dependent. Okay. So, this is what we have done before. IS, remember, is denoting the stator currents, IR is the rotor currents. Okay. Now, T e, which is nothing but minus d omega dash by d theta. In fact, this is in fact only for a two pole machine. Remember that the correct formula in general is T e is the partial derivative, negative of the partial derivative of d omega dash d w dash, which is the co energy with respect to the mechanical angle. So, please remember that this is the mechanical angle. Of course, when we derived L, it is a function of theta, whereas this is theta m. Okay, just remember that. So, what we have is theta m, which is nothing but okay. Now, if we define T e dash to be equal to minus of this, we can show of course that your T TE dash will be equal to minus of half we'll get this as minus of half IS transpose And as I mentioned last time, you won't find LRR coming in these equations because the partial derivative of LRR with respect to theta is equal to 0. And we have already made an observation that LRS transpose is equal to LSR. So, you just get one of them, you know, this simplifies to this. Okay. So, this is what we did last time, we got a TOR expression for TE dash. And once you, of course, do that, you can write your equations as j into d omega m by dt. Just again one small point which I wish to emphasize, this is the mechanical speed, okay? Mechanical speed, angular speed. So, you can write this as 2 times p times the electrical speed, rate of change of electrical speed is equal to T m minus T e, which is nothing but. So, this is basically what we have, and remember T e dash is this. So, if we know, so we have in fact got a relationship between the currents and the torques. So, in fact, just to correlate something we have done some time back, let me just multiply both sides by half omega m square. Okay. So, I will do half into omega m, the base value of that speed or the rated value of the speed into j into 2 by p d omega by dt. Okay. So, I will just multi, I have just multiplied it there is equal to your, you multiplied here also on this side also. So, you will get half of omega m b square into T m minus p by 2 T e dash. Now, what I will do next is divide both sides by the volt ampere base of the machine. Okay. Remember, omega m base is the mechanical base frequency, angular frequency. So, actually it is usually the base frequency is the rated frequency of the machine, okay. Rated mechanical angular frequency of the machine. Okay. So, that is one thing which you should remember. So, actually if you divide by volt ampere base, you will have j omega m b square divided by volt ampere base, okay, into 2 by p d omega by dt is equal to half omega m b square by volt ampere base into T m minus p by 2 T e dash. Okay. Now, a few things, this is what is commonly known as H or the inertia constant of the machine, and its units are joules per volt ampere or mega joules per mega volt ampere. Okay. So, this is called the H of the machine. So, you have basically, if you look at this particular equation, I will rewrite it. So, you can actually write it as, you will get 2 times h, you get this 2 onto this side, okay. 2 times h, I got this 2 onto this side. I will take one of these omega m b is onto this side into p 2 d omega by d t is equal to omega m base divided by volt ampere base into T m minus p by 2 T E dash. Okay. So, actually if you look at how these omega m mechanical base into P divided by 2 would actually give you the electrical radians per second base value. Okay. So, you will have 2 h by omega base. Omega base is the electrical this is the radian frequency base value of the machine. If you look at this, this is in fact the mechanical torque base. Okay. So, you have got T m which is the mechanical torque divided by the torque base of the machine, okay, minus what you have is, I will just rewrite it here. So, it will become very easy to understand what I am doing. Base into P by 2 into T e dash. Just check if it is okay. Volt ampere base into P by 2 into this. Okay. So, finally, what we get is the torque equation of the machine is two h by omega b into d omega by dt is equal to T m in per unit, okay, minus T e dash divided by volt ampere base divided by omega base, the electrical base. Okay. So, this is the final equation of the torque of the machine. In fact, you will note that T dash will be a function of theta m, theta, you know, the inductance matrices will be actually functions of theta, whatever we have derived earlier are functions of theta. So, in fact, if you look at an interesting thing about this is that the number of poles does not appear in this equation. Okay. So, when you write these things in per unit, you will not find the number of poles. In fact, we will express T e in terms of the fluxes and the currents, okay, and the inductance which is a function of theta, volt ampere base and omega b, but you will not get P explicitly. So, actually when you turn, when you go to the per unit system, normally you, you know, you can actually be blind to the number of poles if you are working in the per unit system. Of course, if you want to actually get the mechanical speed, if you know the electrical speed, then you do need require the number of poles. Okay. So, that is of course, something which you should remember. In fact, you can write this in fact like this, 2 h into d omega by omega b. So, this in fact, that is why I call this a per unit equation, everything is in per unit. Okay. Rather, we have not really this T is not in per unit, but it is divided by volt ampere base by omega base. So, eventually of course, after some time I will show you how this everything in this also can be expressed in per unit. Okay. So, this is the final equation, in fact this was the swing equation we used some time back in our earlier lectures. Okay. So, this is the origin of this particular equation. Now, moving on a bit, before I of course, move on, let me tell you that the typical values of h, you know, the typical values of h for a thermal unit can be between 2.5 to 6. This is of course, from for a 2-pole machine, these values I have taken from Kundur's book. For a 4-pole machine and for hydro units, it is usually 2 to 10. Okay. And of course, I have not written the units, they are mega joules per MVA or joule per volt ampere. Okay. So, the unit of H is mega joule per MVA. Now, one of the things you will, if you recall, the equations of the synchronous machine, you will get the rate of change of flux is, you know, dependent on V. In fact, if you recall the formula which I had written last time, the general form is d psi by dt is equal to minus r into I okay, minus V. And if you recall, psi was nothing but L into I. The psi is of course made out of psi s and psi r, and I is also made out of I s and I r, and V is nothing but V a, V b, V c, then minus V f is made out of the rotor and stator voltages 0, 0, 0. So, this is something we did in the previous class. In fact, you can replace, instead of writing it as this way, you can even write it, you can replace this by minus R L inverse psi minus V. So, actually this is, so the only complication when we are trying to solve this equation, this looks actually like a linear equation. Even if you assume that theta is a constant, rate of change of theta is a constant, the speed of a synchronous machine is constant, remember that this L will be time varying. Okay? So, if in fact, if you just look at these flux equations, they are time variant equations, they are linear time variant equations. So, if I want to get the solution of this particular equation, well, I cannot use directly the Eigen analysis techniques to solve this equation. Again, I repeat, this inductance matrix is time varying, it is not a linear time invariant system, it is a function of theta. Even if you assume that theta, rather the speed of the machine is constant, still you will get a time variant set of equations. Okay? So, that is why it will be good to see how you can explore ways to try to analyze this. Okay? Now, one of the most powerful ideas which you have in fact used before is to use the idea of a transformation. Now, transformation is like, we have used transformations. For example, when we were analyzing a system x dot is equal to a x, we tried to find out a transformation which would diagonalize the matrix. The idea was, of course, a diagonal matrix implies there is no coupling between the states. So, if I got x dot is equal to a diagonal matrix into x, there is no coupling between the individual states and you can easily get the solution in terms of the exponential functions. Now, here our aim here, we can use again the idea of a transformation, but right now we will limit ourselves to trying to make these time invariant set of equations, or rather time variant set of equations, into time invariant set of equations. So, what we will do is try to get a transformation of variables, so that we will get this our objective. Okay? Now, of course, how do you get the transformation? Well, what I will do is introduce the transformation directly and see what its consequences are. So, I am not going to derive the transformation for you, okay? But so just let me introduce it to you directly without any further delay. This transformation is called Sparks transformation. So, it is defined as, so, instead of looking at the variables or looking at the differential equations in the variables f I a, I b, I c, or v a, v b, v c, or psi s, I b, psi c, this f could denote any three phase variable. I look at the variables f d, f q and f 0 using a transformation C p. This is a matrix which is dependent on theta. So, that is an important point you should keep in mind. Now, what is this transformation? Of course, the whole key is what is this transformation? It turns out that this is really a very useful transformation. So, C p is equal to, I will just define this transformation. It's a 3 by 3 matrix as you may have guessed, something you may have guessed, that I am applying a transformation only to the ABC variables and not to the field, you know, F, G, H and K variables. Okay. So, only the stator quantities, in fact, the ABC quantities, we are applying this particular transformation. Okay. Now, in fact, just recall, I mean, it is just an interesting correlation which you should recall, that the currents on the rotor become constants in steady state, whereas you know that the currents in the stator or the voltages in the stator are in fact three phase sinusoids. In fact, for balance conditions, you will get three phase balance sinusoids. Okay. So, if I am going to try to make what you call a linear time invariant set of equations, one can kind of guess very intuitively that you have to apply the transformation only to the ABC variables. Okay. So, indeed that is the case. So, this particular transformation which I am going to tell you talk about is actually applied only to the stator variables, ABC variables. Okay. So, an interesting thing about this transformation, even without going any further, is that its inverse Cp inverse always exists, okay, unless of course you choose Kd, Kq, K0, any of them 0. Okay. So, if Kd, Kq, and K0 are non 0, then you can actually get a transformation Cp inverse, which is defined like this. It has this form. K 1 cos theta plus 2 pi by 3. I will just show it this side slightly. Okay. This is K 2 sin theta minus 2 pi by 3, K 3 and K 1 sin theta plus 2 pi by 3. This is K 3, okay, where K 1 is equal to 2 by 3 k d. This is something you can please work out. I am not working it out for you, but you can just, in fact, one simple thing you can do is just multiply C p and C p inverse and just verify that it is actually giving an identity matrix. Okay. Note that there is a minor error here. The 2 3 component of C p inverse should be k 2 and not k 1. So, C p inverse comes out to be this. Okay. Why do you need C p inverse? See, the point is that whenever you use any transformation, any kind of transformation analysis, remember that if I define a transformation of variables, do my analysis in the variables, if I want to know what the old variables were eventually, I would need the inverse transformation. So, in fact, F d, F q and F 0 is equal to C p inverse theta. So, actually a transformation makes sense only if you can go back and forth between the old and the new variables. Okay. So, it is important that C p should be invertible, but it turns out that C p is actually invertible, unless of course, you choose K d, K q and K 0 is equal to 0. So, C p inverse turns out is invertible. Okay. Another interesting thing you will notice, I mean before we go ahead, is that the structure of C p and C p inverse look similar. I mean, if you look at the structure of C p and C p inverse. So, look at C p, there is constants along this column, you have got your sin thetas along this, cos thetas here. Of course, the constants are K d and K q and K 0, whereas if you look at this, the cosine functions are here, the sine functions are here, this is a constant. So, you can guess that for some C p inverse looks like the transpose, at least in structure it looks like the transpose of C p inverse. In fact, for special values of K d, K q and K 0, this is indeed true. So, you will actually for example, let me just let you out on this. This K d and K q, if they are root 2 by 3 and K 0 is 1. If K d is equal to root 2 by 3 and K 0 it turns out is equal to 1 by root 3, in that case C p will be equal to C p transpose. Okay. So, that is one important result which you should keep in mind. Okay. So, some special values of k d and k q, C p transpose and C p inverse are equal. Now, the main utility of this transformation can be seen if you look at the transformation of flux linkages. So, if for example, if you have got we have done this before, psi s and psi r is equal to these are functions of theta. Okay. Now, if I use a transformation, remember I only have to transform the stator fluxes and the stator currents. So, suppose I define as before, this is a 3 by 4 matrix full of zeros and this is an identity matrix I, this is a 4 by 4 identity matrix psi, I will call this d, q and 0 and psi r. So, what I am doing is I am not transforming psi, this is just say psi r is equal to psi r. So, I am only transforming psi a, psi b, psi c into psi d, q 0. Okay. So, that f variable is, I mean, I have just applied whatever transformation to flux psi a, psi b, psi c. Okay. So, if I define a transformation of this kind, how do in fact, a similar transformation can be applied to I s and I r. So, with the same matrix. Okay. So, in that case, it is easy to see that the final equations, okay, this pen, relating psi s, psi d q 0 and I d q 0 and psi r and I r are psi d q 0 psi r is equal to LSS, LSR, LRS, and LRR into CP. This is the matrix of zeros. This is 0, and this is identity matrix of size 4 × 4 into I D Q 0 and I R. Okay. So, what I have actually done is, I have replaced I s and I r by this I d q and I r. Okay. So, I s and I r is equal to C p into I d q 0, I r is equal to I r. Okay. So, I have just replaced this by this. Okay. Then you have got this L r r, then you have got this L matrix. Okay. So, I will just repeat what I said. I have replaced I s and I r by this. Okay. Then of course, L s s, L s r also come here. I mean, I will just show this again. So, this is what we get. And of course, we will get C p inverse here, 0, 0, I 4 by 4 matrix. Okay. So, actually if you get this onto this side, you will get psi s and psi r. Okay. So, basically what I have done is, I have taken this particular equation, here you have got a b c, a b c. This has been replaced by d q 0 here and d q 0 here. Okay. So, what you need to do is, of course, I will rewrite this, you will get psi d q 0 psi r is equal to finally Cp inverse LSS Cp, Cp inverse LSR, LRS into Cp and LRR into, this is multiplied by IDQ0 and IR. Okay. So, this is what we get finally. So, you are now the whole let me just give a sneak preview to what we are going to get. What we intend to do is try to see if this actually is not going to be a function of theta. Okay. So, what we are trying to do is see the relationship between IDQ0 and IDQ, psi DQ0, IDQ0 and IR and psi R and IR. Okay. Now, a nice thing, it would be nice if all these terms came out to be independent of theta. So, in fact, they do. In fact, let me just try to show it at least for one term. For example, if I want to do, I will just show it for one term. I request you to just go and do it for each and every term. Okay. So, what it turns out is that, for example, Cp inverse LSR, just let me try to compute this. Now, what is LSR? So, do you recall what LSR is? LSR is actually Cp inverse. Please look into what we did sometime last in the last class. LSR is equal to LRS transpose, which is nothing but LRS, which is a partition this LSR into two parts, LRSD and LRSQ. LRSD Q is this, has this form, okay, and LRSD has this form. Okay. So, for example, if I use Cp LSR, so what do we have is LSR D and LSR Q. Okay. So, if I actually apply this transformation, what is LSR D? I will just write it down again, M A F cos theta, M A F cos theta minus 2 pi by 3, M A F cos theta plus 2 pi by 3. Then you have got another column. I will not write down that column. This is nothing but L S R D. So, in fact, there is another column. I have not written it down. So, you have got terms here, here and here also. So, if I do C P inverse of L S R D, okay. You know what Cp inverse is? This is what Cp inverse looks like. So, have a good look at this, because we need to fit all our manipulations on a small sheet of paper. So, if you got Cp inverse into LSR, so Cp inverse into LSR D. I am not showing the derivation for all terms, I will just do it for one term. So, if you would do Cp inverse into LSR D, the first component of Cp inverse LSR D, okay, the first component, that is the one component, you can easily, you know, find out that it will be basically the first row of Cp, that is K 1 cos theta, K 1 cos theta minus 2 pi by 3 and K 1 cos theta plus 2 pi by 3. So, this is in fact, so the first term, one term of this matrix, okay. I am just talking of the one term of this complete matrix. Okay. The first term of this complete matrix is nothing but the first row of Cp inverse into the first column of LSRD. So, the first column of MSRD is MAF cos theta MAF cos theta minus 2 pi by 3 and MAF cos theta plus 2 pi by 3. Okay. So, if you multiply these two, you will get the first term of this. Okay. So, I am just doing it for one term. I hope you will be able to follow up on the other terms. So, what you will get if you do that will be, so Cp inverse LSR d, the first term is nothing but, I will just work it out. So, you will get K 1 which is going to be common, MAF which is going to be common, and you will get cos square theta plus cos square theta minus 2 pi by 3 plus cos square theta plus 2 pi by 3. Okay. So, what you have got is, this is the first term of Cp LSR d. Okay. So, remember just before you lose track, let me just recall what we are doing. This is the final relationship between the dq fluxes and the dqo currents and of course, the rotor currents. This has to be evaluated. Remember that Cp is a function of theta, LSR, LRS and LSS are functions of theta. Okay. What I am just trying to show you is the derivation of one term, in fact, the one the first term or rather the 1, 1 term of this matrix. Okay. And I leave of course, the computation of all other terms to you as an exercise. So, I will just do it for one term. So, that term comes out to be K 1 M A F into, yeah, what should it be? Now, this you must have learned of a trigonometric identity, cos square theta plus cos square theta minus 2 pi by 3 plus cos square theta plus 2 pi by 3 is a constant. In fact, it is equal to 3 by 2. So, what we find here effectively is that the first term is this. In fact, we have already defined what k 1 is. K 1 is nothing but 2 by 3 into k d. K d is of course, defined in the transformation C p into M A F into 3 by 2. So, what you get is a very convenient kind of number that is equal to M A F divided by K d. So, this is the first term of this matrix. So, let me just show this to you again. So, what we are doing is we have got the first term of this. In fact, it is not a function of theta, right? It is not a function of theta, it is in fact, M A F by K d, it is a constant. Okay. So, it turns out that the all the terms of this matrix are in fact not functions of theta. So, that is one very interesting effect of this transformation. Okay. So, if I look into the flux and current relationships in these new variables, in the dq variables, you will find that in fact, they are not functions of theta. So, if you look at this particular matrix here, I will just maybe call it some name. Let us just say its terms are LSS dash, this is LSS dash, this is LSR dash, LRS dash and LRR dash. Of course, LRR and LRR, there is no dash here, this is simply LRR because LRR does not get transformed at all. Okay. Then it turns out that all these sub matrices are in fact not functions of theta. So, an interesting if you really sit and derive it, you will get LSS dash is equal to, in fact, it turns out to be a diagonal matrix. Where of course, LD is nothing but written in terms of the what I can call as the primitive parameters L A A 0, L A B 0 plus 3 by 2 L A A 2. What are these L A A 0, L A B 0, etcetera? Please recall that LSS was made out of, you know, this L A A 2 LA A0s and LA B0s. Okay, this whole LSS matrix was made like this. So, LSS dash, which is the relationship between the transound flux and currents, are in fact related by this. And LQ is equal to LA A0 minus LA B0 minus 3 by 2 L A A2. And L0 is nothing but LA A0 plus 2 LA B0. What you notice here, of course, if LA A2 is equal to 0, LD and LQ are equal. So, in fact, when does this occur? This occurs if there is no saliency. So, in fact, LA A2 will become equal to 0 if there is no saliency. Okay. So, what you get is LD and LQ will become equal. Of course, in general it is not true because this is non-zero. Okay. So, one of the important things is it is not only time, it is not a function of theta. LSS is not a function, not only not a function of theta, but it is also diagonal. Okay. So, there is a that makes it very neat. Okay. Similarly, LSR dash is nothing but MAF by KD, MAH by KD, 0 and 0, and you will have 0 and 0, MAG by KD, MAK by KQ, I am sorry, KQ, and 0, 0, 0, and 0. And LRS dash is equal to LSR dash transpose. No, it is not. In general, it is not. That is an interesting point. Okay. So, although LRS and LSR are transpose of each other, this is not true in general. I should show you that it can be made true if you for a certain choice of KD and KQ. Okay. So, in fact, I have not defined what KD and KQ are. Okay. So, they are just arbitrary constants. Okay. So, actually LRS dash turns out to be 3 by 2 times MAF KD and 3 by 2 times MAH KD and 0, 0, 0, 0, 3 by 2 times MAG KQ and 3 by 2 times MAK KQ, and this becomes 0, 0, 0, 0. So, if you look at this and this, it is not true in general. Okay. So, in general, this and this will not be true. Okay. They will not be transpositions of each other. But if I choose KD is equal to KD square is equal to 2 by 3 and KQ square is equal to 2 by 3. In that it turns out, in that case only, okay, it turns out that LSR is equal to LRS transpose. So, this is special values of KD and KQ. Okay. So, what we have done is, in fact, of course, one thing you should see right away that LSR dash and LRS dash are not functions of theta. Okay. That is something which you should immediately see. Okay. And LRS dash is equal to, I am sorry, LSR transpose dash only if for a certain values of KD and KQ. Okay. Now, you should recall that, or just remember that the fact that the relationship between psi and I is not dependent on theta, psi dq 0, I dq 0 is not dependent on theta, is not affected by what value of KD and KQ or K 0 you use. So, this value of KD, KQ and K 0, whatever value you choose, okay, except 0 of course, if you choose it as 0, you will not be able to invert C p. So, in that case, whatever I am saying is not true. But any non-zero value of kd and kq will lead you to this relationship matrix. This is the inductance matrix in the dq0 variables, which is not a function of theta. So, the fact what value of kd kq you choose or k0 you choose does not alter the fact that by using this transformation you can get flux and current relationship which is not dependent on theta. Okay. So, that is one important thing which you should keep in mind. I have not actually derived all the terms of this matrix, it can be quite tedious, but remember that in case you are I encourage you to sit and derive every term of this matrix. I just showed you the derivation of the first term of LSR dash, okay? But you can actually take out the whole matrix, which is in fact a 7 by 7 matrix which has 49 terms from first principles. I mean, you actually do each obtain the expressions for each element in that matrix. In fact, what will help you in doing that would be the trigonometric identities cos theta plus cos theta minus 2 pi by 3 plus cos theta plus 2 pi by 3 is 0. Similarly, sin theta plus sin theta minus 2 pi by 3 plus sin theta plus 2 pi by 3 is equal to 0, and cos square theta plus cos square theta minus 2 pi by 3 plus cos square theta plus 2 pi by 3 is in fact a constant not dependent on theta equal to 3 by 2. The same applies if you replace this cos by sines. Okay. So, these are the two, these are the four in fact if you take the sine identities also. These two cos cosine identities and the corresponding sine identities in fact will help you to get all the terms in this matrix, and you will see that they are not functions of theta. They are functions of kd and kq, and for special values of kd and kq you can in fact ensure that the LSR dash and the RS dash are transpose of each other. Okay. So, what we really see is we have applied the dq transformation. This is called in fact the Parks transformation or a dq transformation matrix, and what we have achieved here is make the flux and the current relationships in the dq0 frame independent of theta. Okay. Now, of course, that does not end our work. Our work is in fact to look at also the differential equations as defined by Faraday's law. Okay. So, what were the differential equations of our machine? In fact, they were d psi by dt is equal to minus r I minus v. Okay. So, that was our equation. In fact, this is in fact a composite equation. It is I told you that in fact this I is nothing but I s and I r. So, this is I is nothing but I s I r, v is nothing but v s and v r, and so on. So, if I just write the stator equations, there will be d psi s by dt is equal to minus r s I s. Okay. In fact, r is a a diagonal matrix consisting of r s and r r. Okay. So, you will get r s I s. So, I can write the component, I mean this is actually I am just writing down the stator equations, okay, minus v s. Okay. So, if I apply, suppose I want to write this, of these are of course derived in the ABC frame of reference. Okay. So, these are ABC variables. Okay. So, if I want to rewrite these equations, they will be, I will rewrite this equation first. I will write it as, so minus d psi s by dt minus r s I s is equal to v s. Okay. So, I can rewrite this as minus of d by dt of C p times psi d q 0 okay, minus Rs into Cp times I dQ0 is equal to Cp times V dQ0. So, all the ABC variables are converted to the dQ0 variables. Is that okay? So, I will just read out this. This is Cp into V dQ0. Okay? This is Rs into Cp into I dQ0. Okay? Cp is a matrix, Rs is a matrix. Okay? Now, before we do further manipulations, one interesting point which I need to emphasize here, what is minus d Cp psi dq 0? Okay? It is nothing but minus of Cp times d by dt into psi dq 0, right? Yeah? This is correct? No, it is not correct. Remember that Cp is also a function of theta. Okay? So, the correct expression would be this plus minus of d by dt of the Cp itself into psi dq 0. Okay? So, that I will rewrite again. So, what you will get is, I will just rewrite it, minus d Cp psi dq 0. Just remember that you have to just take into account this is equal to minus Cp into d psi dq 0 by dt minus d Cp by d theta, and then do d theta by dt, and this is multiplied by psi dq 0. So, what we have, this last term which I wrote down here, will be in fact equal to this last term of the previous equation will be equal to this. So, what we get is the final relationship which we get is this. Okay. D theta by dt is in fact the electrical speed of this machine. So, the key difference between what we have done, the transformation which we have used before and now, is that it is a time dependent transformation. It is dependent on theta. Theta itself is dependent on time, because it is a rotating machine. Theta is continuously changing. It is a function of time. So, what we see is that when you are taking the derivative of Cp into psi dq 0, we have to take the derivative of the transformation as well. This was not the case when we did use the linear time invariant systems with constant transformation matrix. This is not a constant transformation matrix. So, you get this extra d theta by dt term, okay, when we take this derivative. This is not very, sorry, this should be by dt. So, this is in some kind of extra term or extra speed dependent term which comes as a result of applying a transformation. In fact, one important point which you should note is that if we consistently and correctly apply the mathematics, you get this term. In fact, it cannot be reasoned out, why we get a speed dependent term, in the differential equations when you do the transformation, cannot be reasoned out in any other way than mathematically. So, although one can try to give what is known as a physical interpretation to the dq transformation, it is a good idea to first of all work out all the mathematics correctly and then interpret what we are getting. So, let me just again repeat, when you apply a time invariant transformation like Cp on a differential equation, okay, remember that you will have to take the derivative of the transformation itself. And as a result of the derivative of this transformation Cp, you get a speed dependent term, which is also called a speed EMF. Okay? So, we will continue of course, with this derivation. We are coming to the close of the basic modeling of a synchronous machine, but still we have a few things to work out, okay? So we'll work out those things in the next class.